How many know that we have a mass incarceration problem right here in our city? Does anyone know the numbers? In 2015 and 2016, black men alone were six times more likely to be arrested, stopped by the police, and they were more likely to go to jail or prison right here. I just left the Urban League 3 days ago, and I spoke with the vice president of the Urban League. That number has rose between now 8 to 10 times more likely to go to jail or prison from right here in the city of Grand Rapids, Michigan. Do you know how well we rank in the country as far as diversity is concerned? Does anyone know?
Zero?
Kind of low. Very. In 2015 and 2016, according to the USA Today study and the Huffington Post study, Grand Rapids was number 5 worst city for African Americans to live. Once again, that was wrong. We are now number 2 behind Milwaukee, Wisconsin, for the worst cities for African Americans to live. How many know about the economic gap? Do you guys know the actual numbers? The actual number, someone said, The actual number from 2015 and 2016, the average African American makes $25,485. The average white American made $57,186. From my understanding, once again, from the studies of the Urban League, that those numbers had, the African American number has stayed the same, it never moved. But the white American number has risen by 2%. So the economic gap is extremely high. And you say, well, what does that have to do with mass incarceration? It has everything to do with mass incarceration. If you have not seen the documentary, the 13th will definitely explain it all to you. We go all the way back from, it goes all the way back from slavery to the present time of what we hear and what we have now. And it talks all about it. And what we want to do is we want to start the discussion on what you all think that what should be done, what could be done, and if anything, how can we push and help to change legislation? And then what do we do about the prisoners and the guys that are here that are already out of the prison but still in the prison system, the penal system? How do we help those guys? How do we help those young ladies and young men that are out here just struggling? So I'm going to talk over, pass this on to Robert Van Kirk.
Sure. So a little bit about my background. I got a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Michigan State University, and then also got a master's degree in the same. So criminal justice reform is kind of my passion, and one of the reasons why I'm running for office, because I saw the failures, the really abhorrent failures of the criminal justice system from the academic side of things. And when I would do ride-alongs, or when I would engage with police officers, or engage with those who have been incarcerated, and hearing the horror stories of their engagement with the criminal justice system. So that really got me started down the path of criminal justice reform. And through that, I spoke to a lot of very educated professors, folks who know their business, on the path forward to change. And my hope is that if I do get into the State House, that I can help to enact some of those changes that are absolutely necessary. And a big part of that, in terms of the incarceration crisis that we're dealing with, is how we treat drug addiction, right? You treat a healthcare crisis with the criminal justice system, and you're going to get the repeated failures that we've seen for the past 30, 40 years, right? You cannot incarcerate your way out of an addiction crisis. It's just impossible to do. And the more you focus on incarceration, the further you get from rehabilitation, both drug rehabilitation as well as societal rehabilitation, right? So if we want to see real change in our communities, it's up to the communities to take back that power for themselves. And I think a big part of my message running for office is to empower communities around the state of Michigan, but around our Grand Rapids community, right? And it's not just about the city of Grand Rapids, it's about the communities that are around Grand Rapids. So Wyoming is my district. The city of Wyoming is where I'm running for office and where I live. And it's those areas that are around the city of Grand Rapids that we can start to take back the power more directly. The DeVosses control a lot in our communities and have a lot of power and a lot of influence. And they have less influence, though, because they care less about those surrounding communities. So in Wyoming, what I'm hoping to do is build a movement of folks to take back Wyoming city government, right? And from there, we can build on the movement so we can enact real reforms at the municipal level, at the county commission level, and at the state level. And that's where a lot of this business gets done. There's so much attention focused on the presidency, but not enough attention focused on the damage that's done here in our own communities, and that can be stopped here in our own communities. And then I'll just pass it on to you, and I'll bring opening remarks.
Hello, everyone. My name is Andre Fields. As Julius mentioned, I work at GRCC. My main role there is that of counselor, meaning I help students with career counseling as well as personal counseling. And then I'm also the director of Black Male Fraternity there at GRCC. And my educational or research history relates to the psychology of racism, meaning how racism impacts how Americans think, feel, and behave. And so I guess that's kind of my expertise or what I'm working to become an expert at. And so when Julius was giving those numbers, you know, as a psychologist, we're trained that if a group of people have similar outcomes or behave a certain way, it's either because of their genetics or because of their environment. And so when he's giving those numbers, you have to ask yourself, are Black Americans underperforming because of genetics, or is it because of the environment? Of course, if you ask me, it's the environment. Another way to say it is white tribalism, it's systemic discrimination. I was just, fooling around at the U.S. Census Bureau website last week, and there's like 325 million Americans in this country. And out of those 325 million, there are 63% are whites. And so research shows that 53% of white people confess that they outwardly have low regard for Black Americans. That's just the ones who admit it. If you translate those numbers, that's 115 million people in this country who don't like Black people. So it makes sense that if you got that many people in any community, in any country that who has an aversion towards a group of people, you're going to have that gap. You're not going to treat certain people fair. You're not going to give people the right opportunities, the right amount of resources, access. It's just called discrimination. And so if you get a group of individuals who are racist and you put them in one community, one corporation, one system, one institution, what you're going to find is all those biases and stereotypes are going to produce these types of gaps. And so I think as we watch this movie, I think it'll be good. I've seen it once. I don't remember much of it, but if you watch it through the lens of discrimination, it all makes sense. And so it's hard for a lot of Americans to accept the fact that so much of what happens to a person's life, especially a Black American's life, is based upon discrimination. He gave some stats about the worst city to live in. Michigan is ranked the third worst state in the whole country for a Black child to be born, meaning that by the time a Black child dies, their life outcome is going to be worse than 47 or so states in this country. And so, is that an accident or is that systemic? And so I think, again, watching this screening through the lens of discrimination, I think it can open all our eyes about not only how it happens, but what can be done to reverse it. That was a long commercial.
So what I would like to do right now is I'd like to open up the floor before the actual conversation that we want to have, and then we can maybe even spill into our conversational time. But I'd like to open up the floor. Does anybody have any ideas, or does anybody have any comments to refute anything that anyone up here on the panel has said thus far?
Or questions,
or concerns, or comments. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Alicia. I have one brother that did 15 years, and he's out now. I have a younger brother that will be coming out of the system in June or July.
Okay.
I think the biggest barrier for them was coming out to, like, the lack of support. You have the probation officers, or, you know, you have those people that are there to make sure you're checking in, but there's really nothing to really engage them. I guess, you know, you have your exodus place where they can live, or, you know, they offer them as far as employment and things like that, but I just seen a lack of hope in them. Like, everything was drained out of them, so there's nothing really to really pour back into them unless they're in church. But if they're not finding that spiritual outlet, then what else is there?
That's a great point. Reset GR is something that I formulated. I wrote this, created this when I was in prison. I was in prison for retail fraud. I know that sounds really, really funny, but it when I got to quarantine, and when you go to quarantine, you have to go see the warden to get placed. And when I went to go see the warden to go get placed, the warden looked at me and looked at my sheet and looked at my record and said, "Why are you here?" I had no answer. What do I say? I'm here for retail fraud. Why are you here? In my recommendations, in my guidelines, it recommended county jail time. But the judge decided that he wanted to, because he could, he decided that he could, he's going to go over. And he's doing it. He's getting, you gave me to get me that number, to get me that identity. And I totally understand what you're saying. When I got my parole and when I came home, even before I came home, they send representatives to the prison. If you get paroled to a certain program, they send representatives to the prison and they tell you, we will embrace you when you come home. We will help you when you come home. Let me give you the facts. There are two places that you can go when you are released from prison if you do not have a support pass. Exodus House and Mel Trotter. The first thing that they tell you when you leave from prison or you receive your parole is do not be around another felon. Do not be around drugs and alcohol. But the two places that they send you to, other felons, easy access to drugs and alcohol. So Reset's vision and Reset's goal, and this is one of the reasons why we decided to show the 13th and try to engage the community ourselves, and just the person that has the experience that has been through that situation. We want, our goal is to have a one-stop shop. I do believe in, there's a study that says, please welcome, come on in. Come on in, come on in, come on in, come on in. Welcome, come on in. What we would like to do is we would like to have a one-stop shop where the guys that come home, you have counseling, you go see a counselor. Did you not know that every person that comes home from prison, for every year that guy spends incarcerated, he needs to take 3 years to rehabilitate himself from the mental capacity and the mental situation that he's endured while he's behind the what we call it, the wall or the fence. He has to go through it. So where is the mental health when they come home? Because you have to, you've got to adjust. It's an adjustment period. I still have certain things that I'm still struggling with, and I've been home for 2 years, so I still struggle with certain things, anxiety, depression, all of that stuff. So we want that family reunification. We want that as well. We want to bring. We don't want you just to come and stay for 6 months, but not have any permanent housing. I'm finding that to be one of the hugest barriers, that guys come home and they can't find housing. So what we want to do is we want to be able to give them housing, permanent housing, give them housing for the 6 months, but also give them some permanent housing so you can actually get on your feet. We want to fight for equal employment. I know a company right now, I would not name names, but I know a company right now, they hire in people $16 off of the streets. But if you are a felon, you're going to get hired in at $10 because you're a felon. And so you have a guy working on one side of you that's making 16, you're making 10, the other guy that's on the other side of you is making $16 an hour. Please tell me how you are actually helping this guy that's a fellow. That's not giving this guy any confidence to say that, hey, I can make some money, I can take care of my family, I'm doing the right thing, I'm able to build some confidence, my kids can see something good coming from me, and you know, this is the struggle. So I totally understand where you're coming from. If you do not have a support cast, you are pretty much doomed. You're done. You're SOS. You're out of luck. SOL.
So.
Terrible. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, you say there's a certain company that will hire in at $16 an hour, but if you have a felony, you're only allotted $10 an hour. Is that a policy for that company because the person has that felony, and don't they take in consideration that they've already paid the state for their time? They've already set how many years or whatever they had to do behind their bars. You've already, paid your debt to society. So
yes,
why? It's a double standard because you've already paid your debt. Now you come out and you still paying debt because now you can't even make what your neighbor next to you running the same product in this company makes. Why is that, and how do you stop that from happening? I would address that company and see why, because how are you going to get economic stability if you are again prosecuted over for something that you've already paid your debt to society for?
I'm glad you asked that question.
That don't sound right.
So it's not just a pay disparity, but in some states it's have you heard of a Eliminate the Box? It's a program.
Yep.
to eliminate
about
the
that,
yeah.
I have a felony, and I would say the name Pine Rest. I applied for a job. As soon as I checked that little box and said felony, they kicked me out and said thank you for applying.
Yes.
Like, what?
So it's not just pay disparity. It's the fact that it's still legal in many states in this country, including Michigan, to ask if you have a felony record. And it's because they think that that makes you fundamentally a different person. They're looking at this not from the perspective that you've served your time and repaid society and to rehabilitate you back into the community and make sure that you're just like everybody else, but it's because I suppose they're more concerned with the bottom line. And in their mind, a person with a felony record is more of a liability and more of a risk for them. And so there is a movement, though, to eliminate the box, to make it illegal for employers to ask if you have a felony record at any point in the employment process. And so that would eliminate that disparity that we're seeing, both in terms of how much they're being paid, but also in their ability to be hired in the first place. Because your past should not be a hindrance to your future, especially if we're looking to rehabilitate folks.
For the company, what risk are they taking? Because they want you to go in a rehabilitated state coming out. That's why you go through those steps with the probation officer, blah, blah, blah. And the person coming out definitely wants to leave for life and economic stability. So where is the risk of the taking?
It's not right, and it's to me, I don't view it as a risk, obviously, and that's why I'm fighting to eliminate the box in Michigan. But to the companies themselves, they only look towards the immediate bottom line, and in their minds, folks with a felony record present more of a risk than folks without one. And so this is all combined together with our economic condition here in Michigan.
But
you
find
right?
risks. That's what I'm trying to get you. You find the risks that they pose. What's the risk?
In the company's mind, it might be that they fear theft, right? It doesn't make any sense, and it's not right.
Well, it just depends on what the offense is.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's the issue, is they're not asking what the offense is.
They're just
relevant
asking.
To the position?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
they're just
sometimes
asking.
They do.
So it's across the board, you got a felony, so you're a high risk.
More,
I'm waiting for a drug driving. So I'm an alcoholic and got behind the wheel too many times within 7 years and got a felony. Who knew? So when I go apply, I don't steal, I don't lie, I don't do none of that. So I'm still a risk?
Yes, ma'am, because you have a felony.
And that's why we need to eliminate the box.
Well, that's how they dummy us down, because we cannot get up because we're labeled with that felony. Mm-hmm. That's a red line, just like with the housing and stuff. Mm-hmm. They red line us with that felony.
Yes, sir.
And
is it a risk or is it a supply and demand where there's not as many people, or there's not as many employers or hire people with felonies, so they can hire you for less because there's not the ability, there's nothing else.
Well, when you say that, there's a few things that come to mind. What happens is you have a staffing corporation such as Workbox and Snelling and Staffing Inc., those places, and what they'll do is they'll hire the felon, but the company will hire the felon. They'll only hire the felon through the temp service. Okay. So you can't get in straight through the company. Yeah. You can only get, if you have a felony, I can't hire you straight through the company. I can't hire you straight through the door. But what I can do is I can hire you, you can get hired through this temp service. Yeah. So this is how a lot of guys sneak in. So you almost have to suffer. When you come home, you're still suffering at the time. It's almost like you're still locked up. So mentally, the guy or the person that's enduring this injustice is subsequently broken. So if you come out, I can't be politically correct anymore, so please excuse the way I say this, because I really have to just be me now. Okay, so when I came home, first year, I filled out 173 applications. 173. I was out every day beating my feet. When you came home, I was in the MPRI program. What they told me, they gave me a $30 bus pass and they gave me 30 days of toiletries and told me to go make it work. Okay? So I burned up that 30-day bus pass that whole month. Burned. The next month, I went back. I said, hey, listen, I don't know what y'all got going on, but look, I need a job. I need a job lead. Well, I'm sorry, we don't have any job leads right now. Well, y'all told me when I was in Ionia at Bellamy Creek that you all were going to embrace me when I came home. Where's the job at? Well, we need you to go through this program through Goodwill. Okay, I go to Goodwill. They want to talk to me about my finances and my budget. This is what I told them. I don't have any money to budget. Can I have a job? Well, what is your skill set? Oh, gave him my skill set. Oh, you have a nice skill set. Yeah, I do. What jobs is hiring? Well, we need to do this. Can you come back next week? Ma'am, I don't have next week. I have three children, 17, 15, and 10. Another part of that, a lot of guys that are in prison, part of the system, friend of the court. Not a friend of ours. We need to, once again, we have to educate ourselves again. These guys that come out, these guys that are in there, they say they stop the payments. That's a total fabricated lie. They do not stop the payments. The payments is rolling. Then you come home, you don't get a job within that first 30 days. Guess what? You're getting a letter in the mail. Show cause. Come on. Why haven't you paid? I don't have a job. Well, we need to know that you're looking for a job. We're going to give you this sheet. We're going to give you this sheet, and you fill out the job, and you turn it in every month. Did that for 2-3 months. I'm sorry. They gave me another show cause, and I had to go in again. Thank God that I had some folks with me, because if I didn't have nobody with me, every time I go in, they gonna lock you up, and they can lock you up twice. They can lock you up twice a year now. Before that, they can lock you up anytime they want to. 45 days here, 45 days there. You get a nasty judge, you get 90 days. So 45 and 90, that's doggone near half the year. You done spent half your year in jail. So you still ain't took care of your kids. You haven't seen your kids. When you come out, you even have more of a massive bill to pay. So what I'm saying is that once you're in the system just still eats you up. You feel like you got off, I got off parole. I said, oh man, I thought I was the man. I said, I'm free. Looked in the mail, FOC was on it again. So we have to, back to your question or to your concern, it's not the companies. It's the powers that be, the corporations, ALEC, as what we talk about, what the 13th will be talking about. They make these laws with Republicans, and they're greasing each other's hands. So behind the scenes, you got this guy saying, yeah, we're going to give this guy an opportunity, but you got to take this part along with it. So this guy, oh, okay. So we got, and I can't help it. I'm going to keep it real. So we got people that are in public positions, politicking on one end, telling you what you want to hear on one end, but on the back end, they shaking hands and they getting paid under the table. This is why we can't see any progression, because we got folks in places and we're not checking them. We're not checking them. We're not checking them at all. Those stats that we rattled off to you, and those things that we rattled, those are real. I didn't make those up. I got them off the internet. I get them off the websites. Those are real. Those are real stats. We have a problem here. There is something that we have to talk about. So we, you know, the employment, we've got to find companies that are willing to hire these people in the door. We have to start going around. We have to start shaking hands. We have to get out of our comfort zone to go and talk to some people so that we can start getting this thing together. Yes, ma'am.
It seems like a good segue. If I could,
I was just going to say the same thing she is, because we're with the same organization.
Hi.
Hey, that's my flyer.
Do you want it?
No.
Do you want to go?
Do it, girl.
You're in marketing.
No, do it.
Huh? Well, help me out, because she's in marketing. My name's Amy Romitas, and I'm an assessment specialist at West Michigan Works, and she's in marketing.
Yes, ma'am.
You probably did this, huh? And I don't know if it's okay to... I didn't want to just passively stick it up in the front lawn because we have a second chance job fair coming up. I'm not really integrally involved. Hi, Ron. How are you? Integrally involved in the process, but I did used to work at Hope Network in the Exodus program, and it's heartbreaking. It is. I know it's a huge problem, and I feel for anyone who's involved. And I want to be a part of the solution, but my current position, I'm an assessment specialist. I know that assessments and education is a big part of the issue, and whether or not, I won't go into too much detail, but you know, we do whatever we can to just help everyone that's coming through the door.
Yeah.
In any way that we can. So go ahead. I'll let
no,
you.
So it's next Wednesday, the 13th, and it's at our Franklin Service Center, which is located within the DHHS building. All job seekers are welcome, but it's focused towards folks who have a felony record. We're hosting, I believe, 8 employers who are looking to hire people who have a conviction on their background. And really hope that we can get folks down to take advantage of this opportunity to meet employers face-to-face, share their resumes, so if anybody can get the word out, we
absolutely
hope that this can benefit
you
some
folks.
You can post
it on the Facebook event as well.
Awesome.
There was a lot of people that RSVP'd. But really quick to answer your question in the back, I want to make sure that gets an answer. The sad part is currently there isn't much of an answer for that question. And I think that's why a focus really has to be on felony expungement. And so if you change the law in the state of Michigan to where the felony is just expunged, right? So you served your time, you're off parole, you're done, you should be out of the system, that felony should be expunged along with that, right? Because that shouldn't follow you for the rest of your life. And that's the problem, is it is following people for the rest of their lives. So if you want to eliminate the problem, you should expunge the felony, right? Another part of that is reforming the criminal justice system itself. And so what Julius had mentioned, there's just so much to get into. It's this could be a lecture for days. But what he mentioned with a judge, like depending on which judge you get, that's called discretion. And discretion is present all throughout the criminal justice system. And I took an entire class on it. It was very interesting. But the first entry point into the criminal justice system is a police officer, right? That police officer has the discretion whether to arrest you, whether to cite you, or whether to just let you go, right? There's multiple options the officer has, and they can decide at what point you will enter into the criminal justice system. And so that's one level of discretion. The next level of discretion is a prosecutor. A prosecutor can decide to drop the case completely and say, you know what, I'm not going to go forward with these charges. They can say, we're going to go forward with lesser charges, we're going to go forward with the charges the way they are, or harsher charges, right? So there's a prosecutorial level of discretion, and the judge, which he had mentioned, has a level of discretion in terms of sentencing. And so one of the ways to stop this discretion, and the way that this discretion has been used to disproportionately target communities of color all across this country, is by targeting their entry point into the criminal justice system. If you're not being arrested, then you're not being charged with a crime. If you're not being charged with a crime, then you don't have a felony record, right? And so if we can affect the entry point into the criminal justice system by amending the law to focus on treating our communities like our communities instead of communities that we're at war with, if we start acting as if the police are there to serve their communities and not there to, in many cases, exploit the communities for what you had mentioned, the money, right? So I think that's a big part of our criminal justice reform that we can have here in the United States. And on top of that, though, it doesn't do anyone any good when they're rotting in jail or in a prison, right? And it disconnects them from a community. It makes it much harder to get back on the right track if they're serving time. Right, so how can we create a criminal justice system that serves our communities, that makes sure that we work with folks in communities instead of taking them out of a community? How can we keep folks in a community, engaged in their communities, with their families, so that it builds those stable family connections instead of tearing them apart by sending them, what, one of the members, or sometimes two, to prison or jail? Right, that doesn't serve anyone in our communities, and it's not effective. It leads to higher recidivism rates, which means more crime, right? The Republicans saw about crime, right? So if you want to stop crime, if you really want to stop recidivism, then treat the issue, don't incarcerate the issue. And as I previously mentioned, a lot of this does get back to drugs and alcohol. And so if you can start treating folks for their addictions instead of incarcerating them for their addictions, you can lead to a whole host of change up and down the system. And of course, this is also partnered with investments in community in terms of schools, making sure that all of our schools here in the state of Michigan have equal access to a good education so that your zip code doesn't determine your future. That's a big thing that I think can help lead to real changes in our criminal justice system as well as real changes in the lives of the people that live here. So, but I feel like we've dominated so much of the conversation.
No, actually, I'm getting ready to get my guy in here real quick. He said something about schools, and he said something about how we need to change our schools. Is anyone in here familiar with the school to prison pipeline? How many know when the school to prison pipeline starts?
Fifth grade.
Thank God my son made it. He made it out. Rough journey, but he made it.
Amen.
I'm about to get emotional. Before I do that, Dr. Fields, I'd like for you to expound on the education process and some of the guys that you see and deal with on a daily basis. And these guys are college age. And I know sometimes we wish that we would have got to them earlier. Can you give them um, a, a a somewhat of a visual before we turn to the film. If you can give them a visual of what you see on a daily basis and what you hear, because you're there directly with them, talking to them and mentoring them and caring for them. This guy, man, I'm just so God awful proud of this guy. You know, I come in and I may sit down in one of the meetings, and these young men, they're lost, but this guy is giving them hope and direction. We just really need more men and people to give, as we talked about earlier, that there's no hope. And as you said, the young lady up in the back said that, you know, there's guys and her family members feel as there that as there's no hope when they come home, or even while they're there. There's already no hope while you're there because you're in a dark place. But when you come home, you think that you're getting ready to see the light of day, but you don't see anything but darkness. But Dr. Fierce, can you talk about what you see on a daily basis, sir?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I guess I'll try to answer that question and then address the topic you gave me at the same time. So I think I mentioned earlier, I'm the director of a black male fraternity at GRCC. We're going into our sixth year of existence, and we've served about maybe 200 guys during that time. Out of those 200, maybe 20 or so have been in prison, and they're coming back and they're trying to get their lives together. For the young lady back in the back with the sons that are coming out, the first thing I would tell you to do, and it's the same the way I interact with not only the guys that have been to prison, but also those who have not. First thing you have to, when he comes out, you have to make sure his expectations for success are high, but then you have to support him and you have to be patient. Probably, as I work with black males, whether they've been to prison or not, one of the common themes psychologically that they struggle with is the fear of failure. And that fear of failure for your sons may be multiplied because not only do they have the stigma of blackness, I think I mentioned earlier in America, research shows that black males are the most stigmatized portion of the population, but then they also have the stigma of having a felony. So that's almost like a double-edged sword. And so it makes sense to me, when I talk to these guys, we do focus groups at the end of every semester, it makes sense that they have this high fear of failure because they also know, like I mentioned earlier, there's 115 million just white Americans who were honest enough to admit that they have an aversion towards black people. So they know consciously and subconsciously that they're in a maze that's not fair. And so that's going to keep their anxiety up, their stress up, because, you know, I'll give this analogy. If someone leaves out of here and leaves their purse or their wallet, and there's $10 in the purse or the wallet, you're going to be tripping, but you're not really going to be as stressed unless if you left $1,000 in here, right? So what these guys are doing, the more they invest, the more they have stress because they have more to lose. And so what a lot of times psychologically what black men engage in is self-sabotage, withdrawal, and escapism just to get rid of that stress. Because like the more I try, the scarier it gets. And so it's important that when we work with these guys, we constantly affirming them, supporting them, but then keeping their expectations high. And so they have an advantage there because they have other black males who work at the school who serve as living proof, you know, that in America you can navigate that maze and be successful. But I will tell you what your sons have to do in order to overcome that stigma. They have to become good at something. They need to be able to solve problems and be an expert at something. Amen. Because once they can solve the problems of society, they by default become relevant. So it's going to be important, whether it's through college, through trade school, they have to come out as young men and figure out what problem do I want to solve? What am I going to be good at? And so I'm biased. I pushed the higher education path because the path worked for me. I grew up poor, worst neighborhoods, worst schools, no father, all of that. But I was able to navigate through that because I always had a vision. And so it's important that you give them a vision, but then tell them in order to get to that vision, that desired future, they're going to have to learn, become good at something. And so you need to surround them with people who can affirm them, be patient with them, but hold them accountable. Am I answering this question, Jules?
You are.
Okay, yeah. All right.
You are. Okay, you are. And I think the reason why he was asking that is because, I've been there. I saw firsthand. Just to let you in a little bit. I saw four murders and one suicide just in my 1 year of being incarcerated. Four murders. I'm going to be quiet for a minute so you can just let that sink in. Four murders. Witnessed it with my own eyes. One walking right next to me. Guy just walked right past him. Yeah, he's out of there. Blood just everywhere. What do you do? You better act like you in New York and act like you did not see it. I did not. Did you see it? No, I ain't. You know, I did not see nothing. I ain't never lied so much in my life as much as I had to lie in prison. I had to lie. Did you see that? No, I did not see that. I don't want no smoke. I'm trying to go home. I don't want no problems. I'm trying to go home. And once again, this goes back to the mental capacity of what you have to deal with when you're in there. And you know, I get it. You do the crime, you do the time. Absolutely. But once again, what did I go to prison for? Retail fraud. Do you know how much they spend on a prisoner a year?
$30,000.
Say it one more time.
I thought $30,000.
Try $46,000. $46,000 a year for every prisoner that's locked up. That's here in Michigan. Every state is different. The prison system is a multi-billion dollar corporation.
Thank you.
Multi-billion, not million, billion dollar corporation.
Thank English for
that. Who likes Levi's? Who like Levi jeans? Who like the Levi's? You wearing some? You wearing some? You want me to tell you where they made them at? You want me to tell you where they made those at? They made them in Ionia Prison, Bellamy Creek. And they sell them to JCPenney. They have a contract. Yes, they have a shoe company on the prison yard. Let me tell you something else real quick, and then we can start the film.
That's a public institution, not a private institution.
I'm sorry, say it again?
Ionia is a public institution, not a private.
Yeah, it's a public. We do have some private ones here as well. We got a couple of private institutions, but yeah, so it's state rent.
So then public institutions can sell your labor.
Yes, right? Sir.
But private institutions will sell your labor and profit off of your incarceration to begin with.
Yes, sir.
Right? So it's quite lucrative for them, because the state pays them to house them, and then they take all the money from the labor in the facility.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to say real quick, I used to belong to an organization, IWW, and I do believe in organizing prisoners, unionizing prisoners.
Yes, ma'am.
Because your labor is your labor. It doesn't belong to you, the taxpayer. It doesn't belong to the flipping governor. It belongs to you.
Yes, ma'am.
And I just really want to say, IWW has been very much involved with unionizing prison labor.
Yes, ma'am.
That's International Workers of the World, right?
Yep.
International Workers what?
Of the world.
Thank you. I guess my question is sort of what she was saying. Do the wages that they're earning go towards their fines? Or anything like that?
A lot of times it's a commissary.
That would help them out? Do you know what I mean?
But you have access to the commissary.
What happens is yes, if you get, how do I say this? If you have court costs and fines, and let's just say your family members put in $100, you're only going to get 50 of that $100, because that other 50 is going to go to court costs and fines. So let's just say, I tell you like this, when you're working in there, you're not going to even make $50 a month. You're maybe maybe 20, maybe $20. You're getting maybe 20, 30 cents a day.
Well, when you say getting, what is it? Does it go against your account?
It goes to your account, and as I stated, if you, as long as you're under $50, they won't take anything from you. If you're $50, if you're over $50, they'll take that, leave you with 50, and that's what you use to live off of for the month. Deodorant, underwear, toiletries, all the other stuff, food, all of that.
So yes, it's ma'am. Like a little kid getting an allowance, basically.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. But, you know, the labor issue while you're there is kind of bogus, too. So let's just say you get sick and you cannot go to work. Let's say you get the flu and you can't go to work. You'll be going to the hole. You're going to the hole. You lost your job. Go to the hole. You go to the hole for 30 days, come back out, they give you another job. The job they might give you this time, you might not like it. They might stick you in the kitchen. I'm laughing because I thank God I've never had to do that. I've always been with the warden. I had the pretty boy job, if you will. serving the warden. Yes, sir, master. oh, yeah. I laugh, but that's exactly how they treat you while you're there. Hey, get over there and get me something to drink. You keep, what you gonna do? You wearing blue and orange. They'll beat your behind. Or they'll tase you walking backwards. While you walking backwards, you got about four or five of them with the tasers on you. And it's one of you, but it's about five of them, and all of them got tasers. You make the wrong move, you get lit up like a Christmas tree. No kidding. They will light your behind up. They treat you, if you think you're getting treated work, or you're getting treated bad on the streets for just getting pulled over, don't go behind the bars. Matter of fact, don't go to the King County Jail. It's terrible in there. It's terrible. It's worse than prison. I know guys that say I'd rather go to prison than to go to the county. It's bad. It's horrible. But listen, let's try. Is there any more last question? I got room for one more. Yes, sir.
I got one quick question. One of the things, like, on top of everything else,
uh-huh.
You end up losing your voice in civil society.
By absolutely.
Your vote after that. One thing I'd be curious about, just because I have no idea.
Not permanently.
I think, yeah, there are some felons in Michigan can vote, but other states have other laws.
Yeah, okay. That's really what I'm curious about is, like, what is that, the rules around that? Could you vote locally in local elections?
We could vote in the state of Michigan.
Okay.
However, when we vote, a lot of guys don't know that they can vote. Because that's something that they will hide from you. I didn't know that I could vote. I didn't know that until I went. I said I could vote, and I probably almost ran around the church parking lot because I had the opportunity to vote for Barack Obama, and I was so excited that I had the opportunity to vote. I was really excited, like, oh my God, I got a felony, but I still can vote. Yes. I was so excited. I wanted to put it on Facebook. I said, nah, I'm not gonna do that. Y'all ain't gonna be laughing at me on the internet because I said I voted. But it felt good as a felon to know that I was a part of history. But also, we need to start putting some of this information out to the forefront so these guys know. That's some of the reasons why these guys don't believe that they have any say-so or any voice, because they don't know the information. What did they say? They say, you want to hide something from a black guy, put it what? Now, you want to hide something from a black guy, put it on the internet. And hide it. Mask it. And it's been done. One more, and I got to stop the film. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, you had a lot of really powerful statistics at the beginning.
Yes, sir.
Are those available, or did you?
Yeah, yeah. I Googled it.
Okay.
I Googled it. I'll tell you exactly what I put in. I Googled it, and I put in worst cities in America for African Americans.
Okay.
and the Huffington Post popped up, and the USA Today popped up. I'm only quoting the vice president of the Urban League. If you want to go down there, I can give you his. I can give you his email. You can email him. Okay. But he gave me the up-to-date stats that Grand Rapids, Michigan, is now number 2 on the list of worst cities in America for African Americans to live. Yes, ma'am. Last one. I keep saying that.
Did they break that down as to why Grand Rapids is the second?
They talked about. From this is what I can't say it word for word, but from my recollection and from my understanding, they say that Grand Rapids says that they're a diversified and inclusion city, but in actuality, it's just a bunch of folks living together in the city, and we tolerate each other, and sometimes we don't even do that. One article I read from a local person said that they don't feel comfortable with black people working and living in their neighborhoods. And that goes back to what Dre said earlier.
And real quick, we have different studies, but if somebody wants links to those studies, before I leave, I can give you my business card. If you email me, I can send you those links.
Okay.
The study I was talking about with Grand Rapids, they use like an algorithm or formula, but it includes like home ownership, education level, unemployment, things like that. Mm-hmm. And so if you mix all that up and look at it for black people versus white, that's where the gap comes in. And so I think I have one for the state of Michigan and 2 for Grand Rapids, but they also break down the whole algorithm that they use. So if anybody wants that, just get with me.
And honestly, you can just look at city data, city-data, and that is actually a good website to look. And honestly, a lot of times it's right in front of your face. You can look at Zillow, and it tells you the primary and like how much, who's the demographic there as well. So it really doesn't have to take you digging deep or inside of a encyclopedia or something like that, if anybody remembers those things.
Yeah.
But still, you can definitely look at those. City data is what a lot of journalists use. It gives you demographics of the actual city. It gives you the demographics of like certain areas based off of like their zip code. It's a great tool. Or you can use State University. You can actually know the demographics of actual college campuses or college towns as well.
I got room for one more. I promise you. I got room for, well, maybe 2, because actually I was supposed to get this guy first. Let me get him, this guy right here, and then you're the last one, and then I definitely need to start the film, and then after the film, we can come right back. After the film, sir, in the back, I'll start with you. All right? No. After the film. We come back and we'll start with you. First, we're going to start with the guy right here with the great beard that I love.
Back to your conversation about the areas of discretion, police and prosecutors. I had a real poor experience in Zeal in Ottawa County, not a big surprise, with police and prosecutors who didn't know the law, were enforcing the law, teaching the law wrong. How do you fix those areas of discretion? Is community policing review boards? What do you recommend to fix that? Because the police didn't care that I went to the city council, I went to the mayor, no one cared.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, there's no accountability within the police department, within the Ottawa County Prosecutor's Office. And so is the answer to that policing review boards? Where do you fix those areas of discretion?
Sure.
That's a great question. I'm glad that you asked that. Tonight, one of my panelists could not make it. His name is Joe Jones. He is the CEO of the Urban League, and he was supposed to be here tonight, but he could not be here because they called him at the last minute to facilitate this meeting to the very subject that you're speaking to, such as how do we want our police to police our community? I'll say this really, really quick. I said this to Rob in the car on the way here, and I said I can hold my phone up, And I'll ask Rob, what do you see? What do you see? 9 times out of 10, he's going to say, I see an apple, I see a camera, I see a lens, I see this. You ask me what I see all the icons, I see a home button, I see crack screen, you know, so forth and so on, okay? So you ask him again what he sees, he's going to tell you the same thing, what he sees. You ask me again what I see, I say the same thing that I see. What the problem is that when no one is inviting the other to come on the other side of the lens to see what the other person is seeing. And so we're not seeing eye to eye. We keep talking past each other. Another thing is that we're not, once again, we're not holding accountable. This is why organizations, and once again, we're gonna at the end of the discussion in the film, we're gonna have a call to action, because we can talk about it all day long until we're blue in the face. We really need some action. I'm just old school. My father used to say this saying all the time. He said, "Listen, don't talk the talk. You need to start walking the walk. Don't talk about it. Let's be about it, and let's be about that action." This situation needs some action as we say right now. So yes, the organizations and organizing and putting pressure on the powers that be. How do we do that? That'll be something that we need to sit down and discuss. How does that look? But yes, we do need to organize and make some noise. If we have to call the media in, call the media. If Channel 8, News 3, or 13 doesn't do it, we come out with our own cameras and we video and we put it on GRTV. We put it on our radio stations. We do this. We infiltrate. This is something that we control. When you hear the chants in St. Louis and Ferguson, Missouri, you hear the chants, whose streets? Our streets. This is our streets. We pay, right?
Right.
This is ours, right?
That's right.
So why is it that we're acting like they own it and we're scared to say something about it? If it's wrong, it's wrong. I don't care what color you are. Mass incarceration just doesn't affect black people. It damages more. It damages more black people than it does. But it affects everybody. It's a everybody situation. But 9 times out of 10, when you think about it, when you say incarcerated, when you say drug dealer, who do you think about? Let's just be honest. Who do you think about? You see a black guy, and he got his jeans a little saggy, or he got his hoodie on. What you thinking? Let me hit my lock on my car. It's the media and the narrative that they're pushing out. I'll give you another prime example, and I promise I'm gonna, that's my last example. I promise you. This year, I went down to the Grand Rapids. I went down to the Grand Rapids. What was that? We had our prize. Did you guys know that there was an African American festival going on Saturday? Mm-hmm. How many knew that? But y'all knew our prize was happening, right? How many media outlets covered the African American festival happening at Calder Plaza? And News 8 was right down the street, right around the corner. But the moment that you see something happen in a predominantly black community, you're quick to see it on the news. Just something to think about. With that being said, if we can go ahead and cue it up and we can get that started.
If I could just really quick throw in this response to that, in terms of eliminating discretion or rolling back some levels of discretion. If the police are flagrantly violating the law themselves, then that's something that the Attorney General of Michigan is supposed to step in and intervene to do. Well, and that's because Bill Schuette is the Attorney General of Michigan. So let's be clear, you need an Attorney General that gives a crap to actually intervene. But that is the role and responsibility of the Attorney General, is to intervene when the prosecutors are doing some shady stuff, if they're not intervening, if the police are doing some shady stuff. And so there's levels of those checks and balances. But if you change the laws themselves, right, if you change the law so that The ability for the police to arrest you on an offense is limited, or more limited, or requires more evidence, more proof that something occurred, then that changes your entry point into the criminal justice system, right? And so that's one of the ways, or multiple ways, that we can address the issue of, I would suppose, police and prosecutorial discretion or indiscretions. Is another way to put that. But yeah, we should probably start the film. So. But afterwards, please stick around if you're interested. We'll continue this discussion. And more importantly, this is part of a series of film screenings. The next will be at Grand Rapids Community College.
Yeah, the next will be at Grand Rapids Community College.
And
we're targeting January 17th, building and building and time to be announced. Please be on the lookout for that. Mm-hmm. But as we stated, we thank you for so much for coming out. We apologize for the, maybe there may have been some confusion because we had another event going on in the other room. We apologize about that, but we're here. Point being is that we're here, you're here. We're going to show this film and we're going to try to get something started. We're going to try to see what we can do. We'll come back at the end. Thank you guys again.
How do you get people to really have an honest conversation, and how do you get people to see the benefit of changing things and putting in the long-term effort of not getting immediate results, instead changing the system and seeing results in 5 years or a generation from now? It just is overwhelming.
I totally get it. I totally understand. When I first saw the film, I'm not an emotional guy. Prison has made me learn to not. You can't cry when you're in prison. It's a sign of weakness. They'll try to take advantage of you. So prison has almost numbed my emotions. There's sometimes where I'm not sure if I have it or if I can show any rather. I think that's another thing that Dr. Fields talks about. There's a lot of guys that we just won't show any emotion. But when I watched this film the first time, I cried because everything that I was going through, she spoke on. It touched. My question now to you all, since you have seen the film, did you all have any reservations before you saw the film? And now that you've seen the film, has anything changed?
This is just a reminder, nothing's changed. I mean, I'm an old guy. You know, that's what's really scary about it, you know. And I've been working with people that went to prison and had some troubles myself, and it's so scary how little has changed, how it's all still the same. I mean, it takes different, you know, forms, but the racism is still there, you know. The system trying to divide people rather than figuring out how to get people kind of solutions, it's all still there. I guess if I was going to give you advice, it would be, you got to start over again at the grassroots.
Yes.
If you're going to make any difference. Mm-hmm. It's got to start in politics. It's got to start with law enforcement at the grassroots. got to start with the court system here in Kent County. You know, that's where you're going to make a difference.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
You know, I watched this, and I couldn't help but think of what's going on. Is it, what's the school on Madison? Is that Martin Luther King?
Yes, ma'am.
Academy?
Yes, ma'am.
You know, I couldn't help but think about what was going on there tonight. And if you don't know, that's where the, I guess they're trying to do some kind of image control with what happened with the young man that was shot in the chest by the cop.
Yes.
And, you know, you keep thinking, will it never end? And I just have a favor that I would like to ask of you when you, and Robert, are you part of showing this film?
Oh, yeah.
Series? Okay.
Yeah.
And you, and Dr., what was your name?
Fields. Audrey Fields.
Dr. Fields. Yeah. I have a favor I'd like to ask of you. When you show, especially since CC does have a criminal justice department, when you show this film again, please not only try to get some kind of publicity with this, but I'm going to ask that you ask the chief of police. I'm going to ask that you ask whoever the head of their union is. I'm going to ask whoever the prosecutor was in this situation. I'm going to ask that you have him there. And I don't know if the family needs to be a part of this or not. I don't know the family. It may be very instructive if they are. But I'm going to ask that you make sure that those individuals are there. And that they see this movie, and if you have to make them part of your panel to get them to talk, at least get them to, they may not verbalize, but at least get them to see this. And I'm gonna ask if y'all would do that. If y'all want to help with that, I'm glad to do it.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Afterwards, please don't let me leave, or don't leave without speaking with me. I'm very interested in making that happen. We just kind of looked at each other and agreed. I just, you know, hey, for the next one, can we make that happen? And this was the first event that, you know, we had an opportunity to put on, and I'm actually proud of the turnout. I'm actually surprised at the turnout.
You should be proud of the turnout. You should be proud of every aspect of this.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, you should be proud.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Here's what I'm thinking, and I want to hear from you. You guys have heard me pretty much all night. I really want to hear from you. After watching the film, and some of you who've worked with felons and some of you who are passionate about this, what are some of your ideas that you think that could help? Where do you see that we start? My idea and where I believe that we should start is we need to stop the bleeding, because there's people coming out, and it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse. And I feel like we need to stop the bleeding on one end, but we need another team at the front end at the same time. So we can't just focus on one area. At this particular time, I think things have gotten so far out of hand that we can't just say we need to focus on reentry or we need to focus on legislation. I think at this particular point in time, we don't have time enough to do that. And I think that we're in a state of an emergency. Mm-hmm. So if there's a way that we can put together a team takes care of the front end, and then there's a team that takes care of the back end, I think that's what I'm trying to do here. I'm really trying to bring bring us together, but yet find strengths of people's strengths and say, hey, we can put you with team A. Maybe you work well with team A and you can fight and stay in contact with how we could do this with team A on the front. If you're great with legislation, then let's figure out how we can get that part of it organized. If you're great with reentry, great with people, and even if you're retired and you're not willing to get into the trenches like that anymore, feel free. I am a sponge. If you are here, I'm a sponge. I don't care. I read all day. That's all I do is read all freaking day. If I'm not reading, I'm out talking to somebody. If I'm not talking to somebody, I'm going in somebody's store. So I'm talking to anybody that will listen. That was the reason and the whole focus and the whole reason why I put this together, so that I can bring the community together so that we can talk. It's ridiculous that, as I stated with the earlier example, to where we're talking past each other. He sees Apple and I'm seeing 907 Wednesday, December the 6th. I'm seeing Watch Live, my ESPN app coming up. And I ask him what he sees. He still sees Apple and a camera. But if I say, hey, sir, can you come on this side and I'm going to show you what I see. And then we can see what each other's are seeing. And now let's look at this together. And now let's figure out what we can do to do something about this, instead of us going back to our own quarters and saying, hey, let that person deal with it. So I guess that's what I'm trying to do. And please forgive. Don't mistake my passion and don't mistake me the tone in my voice for being facetious at all. That is not my intent. I'm really merely talking this way to keep from crying, because I'm not the only one that's suffering. It's more people that's suffering. But the fact of the matter is that if we cry, the more we cry and the more we holler, that's the more we get ignored. And so I'm hoping, I'm looking for somebody to fight with me. I'm not scared. My father was a boxer. My grandfather was a boxer. My baby brother is a boxer. He's going pro. So when it comes to fighting, maybe not physically, but mentally, I am strong as an ox, and I will not stop. I'm stubborn. That's probably one of the reasons why I got myself into trouble. However, I learned in prison that you can take that stubbornness and you can turn it around and be stubborn for good. But I'm stubborn right now. I won't leave here until I know that I got at least three people that's ready to fight with me. I just need to know I got three.
Come on.
Let's do it.
I just need to know I got three. I hear you. Now I just need to know, what does that look like? Where do we start? Who's good with legislation? Yes, ma'am.
Well, I'm not good with legislation, but I was at GDSU about a week ago, and we did something called design thinking. And what we did in teams is we sat together and came up with multiple ideas, and then, like, within an hour, came up with a solution and put it all together. So I think, like, the more people, I don't mind being one of those people on your team to say, okay, I'm a problem and solution finder. That's what I do. So as far as getting multiple people together with ideas and then coming up with a model of what it would look like, because the biggest thing, like you said, urgency, but also outsourcing funding. I think of my situation with approaching mentors in the city. It was more or less, that's your responsibility. Your children aren't responsibility. You figure it out. So what I did, I took my human services degree and I came up with a plan for my kids. Like, I said, I thank the Lord for that, because I said it was so, not humiliating, but just it drained me to seek and seek and seek and seek and be met with the door closed. So I think that the more people you put together and the different personalities you put together, then you come up, okay, let's sit at the table and just hash it out and brainstorm. I have the sheet. I can, you know, send you a picture or whatever, what the steps were with design thinking. But I really believe that it would help in coming up with a fast solution. Like you said, have your team who are fighting on the forefront, but then also helping those rehabilitate as they come out.
Absolutely. I love it. I love it. Please don't leave without us exchanging information personally so that we can reach out. And we'd love to reach out. Are there any men in here that are interested? No, no offense to the ladies. No offense. Please. No, I'm serious. And the reason why I say men,
That's a whole other documentary.
That's coming.
It is a whole other documentary. It is a whole other subject. But at this particular time, we need some men as well. We need some men to talk. Yes, sir.
I'm willing to take part.
Okay.
Let's build community and take action.
Let's exchange information, sir. Yep. Let's exchange. Yes, sir. Yeah, oh, yeah, absolutely.
What I'd like to see is some education done in this town, particularly for communities of color, what your rights are, you know? How you should respond, what you're allowed to do, what you're not allowed to do if you're getting harassed by the police, what your rights are if you are arrested, and so forth and so on. There's a, you know, I worked in reentry, I worked a little bit on the front end too, and there's so many people that get caught up in the system that don't have any idea what their rights are. They don't know what the right questions are to ask their overworked attorney. They don't know the right questions or when to close their mouth when they're talking to the cops. Doesn't mean they're guilty of anything, but sometimes you can make yourself guilty just by opening your mouth when you don't have to.
Absolutely.
And on and on and on and on, you know. And so, you know, if you could organize anything, and I might even be able to get you a couple of attorneys that would be willing to show up now and then. If you could organize, you know, kids of color from age 14 to 23 to show up once a month or once every couple months, a bunch of them, and could figure out what, that would go a long way. It really would. And it would hold your police departments accountable. All of a sudden, they wouldn't be the bullies they once were if they knew the people that they were harassing or actually knew what their rights were.
Good. That's really good. I thought about that, and I thought about, I know this is going to be a little controversial when I say this name, so, you know, don't pull your guns out and shoot me. Okay? I'm just praying. Colin Kaepernick.
Yeah.
I was just waiting on. I got the look it because I was looking for the gun. Anyway, but Colin Kaepernick has a program and it's called the Know Your Rights program.
Exactly. I was thinking of that too. I've heard of it.
I'm not really good. Like I said, this is a. I quit my job to create this because, as I stated before, if I have to be the sacrificial lamb. To kick it off. If it's the media and they want to come after me and dig up my dirt, I don't have nothing to lose. I don't have anything to lose. Yes, ma'am. Come right back to you.
I just want to say, an observation, like a personal observation.
Yes, ma'am.
Me, like going through my own head. When I was watching those old reels and everything, I'm realizing how brainwashed we were from the time we were little, and seeing a sea of white faces,
yes, ma'am,
and not even realizing what was going on, you know, in the backdrop. Like we were being brainwashed basically.
Yes, ma'am.
Throughout my whole life. I'm 66 years old. Mm-hmm. That's what I see. My friend Dean, that is sitting right next to me, is honest enough to tell me how it feels to be black or what is the black experience in this situation. I want her to go with me to Grand Haven one day. And she explained, we don't go to Grand Haven. Why? That's white privilege. What is white privilege? I'm 66 years old. Mm. You know what? I'm just being honest. I notice things in this movie that I have never thought about before.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I think I saw maybe a second rendition of the same movie. I saw a lot of the clips and some of the interviews and such, so this is kind of my second time through this. It nails it. Tells us where we are today. And shows us how we got here, where we are. Two things I've heard today is Paula and yourself. And Paula says, you know, certain figures of should be in the room and on the panel. I think the system has snowballed to where we are today. Because I really don't think any of us could sit in the room and talk about this and say, this is right. I don't think any of them would. I don't think they could explain themselves and explain their jobs and explain their positions. I don't think it's possible. That's the way I feel. Okay? And then your comment that you said something about, oh, it's your problem, you deal with it. It's just a system, you know? I get that, I hear that, you know? So I really think that's where we're at. those are just my observations. You ask for three guys in the room to put their hands up to help. And I would do that, but I don't know where to, you know, I don't know a solution. I don't know, you know.
I guess
it was the multi-step thing.
So my hope with screening this film and starting this community discussion is that you don't leave here feeling hopeless, but you leave feeling inspired. And you leave feeling with there is a direction that I can go to change this, because there is. And the thing that I tell people all the time, pretty much everywhere I go, is that you have all the power.
Absolutely.
That the powers that be, the powers that you have ceded control to, they want you to believe that you don't have power, that you don't have authority. But that's a lie. And that's a lie that keeps them in power and keeps them in that authority position. And so if you have a problem with anything you saw, if you have a problem with the way that our society functions, you have the power to change that. And it's harnessing that power and sharing that knowledge with people around you, that you can be that change. You can be the person that makes those decisions. That's my hope for doing this film series, for doing the town halls, for engaging in this, is that you can leave with that.
At the individual level, one of the best things you can do, of course, is not be discriminatory. The purpose of racism and stigma is to justify discrimination. So going back to what you just said, society has conditioned us to be racist. It's so powerful that even, like someone stated earlier, blacks are racist towards blacks. And so with that conditioning, again, the purpose of it, we can't first discriminate and mistreat black males until we put that stigma on them. So as a police officer, I can't justify profiling this black male without first having that stigma on that black male. And so at the individual level, being cognizant of the fact that you have been trained and conditioned to be discriminatory towards blacks, now you have the responsibility to not engage in those behaviors. Another thing you can do is just educate other people, hold other people accountable. As a black male, I may not get through to one of the GRCC students currently in the police academy. Because I become a police officer and I take 20 classes, that doesn't reverse all of that years of conditioning to become a racist. And so I put on a badge, now I'm even more dangerous. So you can't have a racist education system, criminal justice system, healthcare system without racist individuals. And so as individuals, step one, don't be a racist yourself and don't discriminate yourself. That's the first thing you can do. And then try to help and teach others. And then I think that's the immediate thing. And then as we work together to bring legislation, to get people hired in higher positions and things like that, I think that comes along the way. But the number one thing is on your own, don't be discriminatory.
Yes, ma'am.
How have others worked to get companies not invested in ALEC? I mean, what could we do there?
The American Legislative Exchange Council.
Right. Yeah. Privatization.
So not only do you have electoral power, right, but you also have purchasing power.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. So you have the ability to choose where your money goes and does it support these types of institutions. So the best advice and the quickest advice is to shop local. Mm-hmm. Right. So first go to your small businesses before you go shop at the national chains or whatever. Always try to shop first at smaller businesses, local businesses. And that will take care of that problem, because you don't have to worry this money's going to go somewhere else. Right. So that's the first step of advice. But beyond that, write to those, I don't know if any of you have considered this, but write to Levi as a company, right? So you're concerned about, you know, telling your congressman how you feel. What about the person you buy your jeans from? And say, I don't like how you produce your jeans, and I will not purchase your jeans again until you prove to me that you have discontinued this practice, right? And so it's not just writing to your congressman, but write to Levi. Mm-hmm. And I can guarantee they don't get a lot of letters. Uh-huh. And so if you want to have a real impact, target those companies that were mentioned. And start a letter writing campaign. Talk to your friends. And say, hey, let's all write letters. Let's sit down in a room together, have some mimosas, write some letters, and you know, send out to the head of Levi's. And so that's a way that you can target it beyond just shopping local. And then maybe we can start changing some of those companies' practices.
Is there a list of local, you know, ones that
we can post that on the Facebook page?
I do know for the African American community, we do have an organization called GRAB, Grand Rapids Area Black Businesses. The operator is, his name is Jameel Robinson. We have a lot of black owned businesses. They just don't really get the mainstream recognition and the revenue. So a lot of people don't know that they have, you know, that we have the same products that the huge store chain stores have, if you will. Talking about businesses, local businesses, and sharing that information also is great. Whether you're sharing it via Facebook, whether you're sharing it through our website, like I said, via social media, or whether it's good old fashioned word of mouth. We really need to start pushing that narrative out there and shop local. And that means that our money comes back to our community. I'm sorry, you had a question. You had your hand up just a little while ago.
Me?
Oh, the guy right behind you. Sorry about that, sir.
I don't remember what I was going to share.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I should have got to you earlier.
In the back. So, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm on a work group through. Have you ever heard of the MICA Center?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Of organization.
Yes, ma'am.
Just that work on social justice, and I'm on their Beyond Prisons work group. And we've been very involved in going to the city commission. We got very involved after the four young men, you know, were held at gunpoint on the street. We went to met with their parents and their mothers and that kind of stuff. And we're trying very much to get more people of color coming to our work groups, you know, because there's nothing worse than a bunch of white people trying to figure out, you know, your answer.
You know, can I be honest? Mm-hmm. I've been to the MICA Center four times. Mm-hmm. I've had a meeting with the executive director, and I've had a meeting with another person that is under her. I don't feel I'm getting anywhere. Great ideas, great people. The person that she told me that I needed to partner with, I've been trying to partner with him for a whole year. He has not, he's seen my emails. He will not respond to them.
Is it Albert?
I'm sorry?
Is his name Albert?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. I'll tell you. You know, I don't know everybody in this room, so you know, I don't want nobody hunting me down after that. I'll tell you, though. I'll tell you exactly who it is. But that when I tell you what it, that is the problem. If, hey, go partner with this person. You should partner with this person. This is what was told to me. I can't put the full weight of the MICA Center to partner with you because I'd be stepping on somebody else's toes. Because the person that is there has some pull. I'm gonna be. I'll give you another. I went to talk to the executive director. She couldn't be here. She was gonna send somebody, and the person that she was gonna send, she was really reluctant to send. Because the person that she was going to send may have said the wrong thing, not knowing that she was going to say the wrong thing, and it could have been offensive and disastrous. So these are the issues and these are the challenges that I'm running into, talking to people and trying to partner with people, because everybody has their own agenda. Listen, I'm not trying to get rich. This isn't a get rich. This is not a get rich career. I'm trying to help some folks, and I'm trying to help save some lives, and I'm trying to keep some people from going back to prison and getting swallowed up by this monster. This is a monster. And if you get into this cycle, it's not easy to get out of it. It's very hard to come out of it. My mama used to say, boy, it's easy to get in trouble, but it's so hard to get out. That's exactly what it is with this criminal justice system. It's easy to get into, but hell to get out of. And if we're fighting for the same thing, what's the problem? Why won't you partner with me? Why won't you return my phone call? At least be courteous enough to return an email and say, hey, we're not, your narrative or what you have going on, it just doesn't fit well with what we have going on over here. But to not respond deliberately after I've tried for a whole year, it kind of makes me look at the Micah Center a little different.
Yep. Yeah.
I'm upset to hear that, you know, that just really...
And I'm sorry.
Share the name.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry that I had to put the Micah Center on blast that way, because that's not my intent. Yeah. But in order for us to move forward, and in order for our narrative to be pushed, and in order for some action to be done, some things have to be exposed. Mm-hmm. And as I stated, I'm not speaking against the Micah Center, because the Micah Center does great work. But however, in this instance, social justice reform, and we're talking about what's going on, and I'm one of those guys that's suffering, and you're ignoring my cry, you're doing the same thing that the people in the powers that be are doing to me. So why should I trust you?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am.
You're next,
sir.
I'm an anti-racism trainer for about 15 years, and one of the things that we do is help people understand how the history brought us to where we're at right now. And another thing that comes after people have come to the point of willingness to receive the fact that history jacked us up with regard to these issues, because it got started years and years and years ago, and then it just got loose like freight train with nobody driving it, is to get people together in an intimate way.
Amen.
To talk about how they're going to get the knowledge that they've received out of their head and into their hearts, so that they can stop theorizing what different people need to do and start internalizing how this has affected them. That sitting on the sidelines is no solution whatsoever, because this is going to get us all. The engine that's driving mass incarceration is going to suck us all up before it's all said and done. We all lose.
Mm.
So how do we get people to think about, how am I going to get my heart engaged in this? How am I going to act like it's one of my kids who's caught up? I have a son that was in prison for many years, and I didn't think that I could speak on this because I thought people would discount my message because I'm a mother. But when I read Michelle Alexander's book, I realized how this is going to get us all.
Yeah.
And if we don't step up and figure out how we're going to get this knowledge that we got here tonight watching this, this is my sixth time watching it, if we don't get it from our head and into our heart to a point where it causes us to start losing sleep.
Mm.
And how am I going to get nervous enough about something that I don't even know anything about to learn enough about it to find out where my place is in this? Because we don't know. If we're just watching this for the first time, if we're just now getting involved in this information, we have no idea in what capacity we'll be able to utilize our gift set.
Right.
But if we don't even expose ourselves, and if we keep it in our head and don't make it a part of what's really transforming who I am, we just don't know.
Right. That's a great point. I can't even respond. That point is excellent. If you guys don't know the book that she's talking about, it's a book that I'm reading now for the fifth time. The name of the book is called The New Jim Crow. And it's by Michelle Alexander.
She was on the
documentary. As a matter of fact, she was on the documentary. She was here a few years ago speaking on the book. And from my understanding, this kind of hurt me really bad. There wasn't very many black people at that event. From my understanding, I read this book. Like I said, I read it about five times. And I knew about it. I knew about the book. But they didn't advertise that she was coming. Mm-hmm. It wasn't advertised well. And I know some of the people say, well, you didn't advertise this very well. You're absolutely right, because I knew that there was a limited amount of seating. So if I would have went on the radio, I'm very well known here. I've been in every black church to sing in the city. I'm known. All I had to do was get on the radio, go on two or three different radio shows and say that I'm throwing an event, and this jugger would have been full. It would have been overflowed. Yeah. Via Facebook, we had 800 and some people that were interested in coming. And 110 people, I believe, that said that they were coming. So, but man, the room is full. There were so many people in and out. So I'm quite sure that it was at least 100 and something people that stopped in and came. And honestly, I am so humbled and so grateful that you guys took the time out of your busy schedule to come to an event to discuss what's going on in our community. I really want to take the time to thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. If I had a dollar or $10 to give everybody for coming, I wish I could. I would pay you for coming. Thank you. That's just how much I'm humbled that you guys came out. Thank you so much. This is something that I'm really passionate about.
Seriously, yeah.
I know I got a couple of people that wanted to say something, and I don't want to end it without everybody and the people that wanted to say their piece to be able to say their piece. I got my guy right here in the red. I got my guy back here in the back right here, and I have young lady sitting right here. So we're going to go in that order. One, two, three.
Yeah, I've spent many years working in nonprofits and around the area, the issues of social justice. But I think one of the things that we don't know is how to be allies, you know, and when it comes down to working with a microcenter, you know, not anything against, but they exist in their own bubble too, just like I exist in my own bubble.
Absolutely.
And to the extent that I don't break out of that bubble and connect and look at the other side of that phone alongside you, you know, and even when I do that, I need to follow your lead because you live in it, you know?
Absolutely.
And I'm walking with it.
Absolutely.
You know, and that's the thing that I think we what kind of context do we have to even know what an ally would do? I can't lead the charge on racism, or classism, or ableism, or, you know, any of that stuff, ageism. I can't lead the charge on those. Maybe ageism someday. But I can't, but I can be an ally, I tell you. And I need to, because I'm part of this community, and that means.
And you know what? And that's for me, that's good enough for me. This is what I tell white people all the time. Excuse me. This is what I tell them. And that's all pretty much who I hang with is white people, but except when I'm hanging out with Drake. But this is what I say. If you see something and you see it's not right, you know it's not right. It doesn't sit well with you. It's just as wrong for you not to say anything as it is for the person that's doing it. So if you hear somebody talking like, hey, why don't you go back to where you came from? And you're standing there and you just,
oh, he wasn't talking to me.
I didn't see nothing, right?
Hey, you know, no harm, no foul. You know, hey.
Is that your white voice, Julie?
Yeah. I took a couple of acting classes. But you know, we just can't go on as like, you know, oh, that's just life. You know, hey, that's that. Hey, that's his fault. That's his fault for what?
I like one of the signs in the movie, silence is violence.
Absolutely. Absolutely. If you're silent, you're promoting it. You see it, you're silent, you're promoting it. So to the gentleman's point here in the front and to Dre's point, your first job is to not be discriminatory. Your second job is, if you see discriminatory, call it out.
And I just want to connect to that. Silence is violence, but so is inaction.
Right.
If you know that the system is broken and you do nothing to fix it, then I would say that you're complicit in that broken system. And so if we have these problems with our society and we have these problems with our police, if we have, like, who appoints the police? How do the police get hired? It's because you have a chief of police. Who appoints the chief of police? The mayor. Who appoints the mayor? You. You got a problem with this, go to the source. And the source in this instance is the mayor, right? Or if you got a problem with this, go to the city council and the mayor, because the city council can direct the mayor to change the action. And so both with the power for change comes the responsibility for change. That if you see these problems happening, you're responsible for helping to correct them. You can't just say, well, you know, I wish the mayor would behave better. I wish the mayor would make the police chief behave better. I wish the police chief would instruct his police officers to behave better or change their ways. That's on you. And it's your responsibility to change that system. It's all of our responsibility to change that system.
Absolutely.
And that's, I just can't hammer it enough. Like, you have the power to do that. And I sound like a broken record, but that's because I'm so exasperated, because I feel that powerlessness. And I know that's one of the major things that we have to work to change in our communities, is that sense of powerlessness, because you have to be empowered to be that change, because you can be that change. And I don't know of a better way to tell it other than just take back the power for yourself.
That's good.
And your community. So.
That's good.
Sir, real quick, can I ask you real quick? Just 30 seconds?
Nope, or that's the doctor. When the doctor speaks, everybody be quiet.
As it relates to being an ally, I think the most important place to be an ally is in the workplace, because that's where you have the most ability to impact not only somebody getting a job, keeping a job, being treated fairly, but now that's economical help indirectly, at all levels.
Oh, that's good.
The system is weird and tricky, and it's always finding a way to weed black people out because of that systemic discrimination. Yeah. I've lost my job. Last year I had a PhD. Well, I've written 7 books in the last 2 years. I run a mentoring company, and because of the 10-year system, I actually lost my job. But by the grace of God, the higher ups, who happen to be white, overturned it, and I kept my job. But it takes the workplace, you know, that workspace is, because it's all about resources. The purpose of discrimination is to accumulate resources for you and your people. So consciously and subconsciously, I think because of evolutionary principles, we find ways, or I'll say white Americans for now, they find ways to unfairly distribute resources so they can retain their resource holding potential.
That's good.
So that's the purpose of racism and discrimination. And so it happens at all levels. So if you want to think about how can I fight this, it's probably going to be at your workplace.
Sir?
You look at the criminal justice system, you know, which we just watched the last year, a couple of hours. And I feel this way. I look at around the room here and I look at everybody. And I think we all feel this way. We all have. I have a daughter. You know, just a daughter, you know, but we have sons, you know. We all feel that we could wind up in this same system. Some of us have parents,
yes, sir.
Okay, that we know could wind up in the same system. The reality of it is, and we all know, maybe haven't thought about a great deal about it, but we all know we can walk out of here, get picked up on our way going home tonight, and wind up in this system and it may be the last anybody ever sees or hears her.
Right.
And that's, you know, so we all feel the same. I know your situation, and, you know, thank you for doing what you're doing, and you've come through the system, and you've been there, unfortunately, you know, and you're out, and you're on the other side of it now, and you're doing what you're doing. And thank you for doing that. I'm sure there's a lot of guys out there who you're friends with and you're helping out along the way.
Yeah.
We all feel that way. I'm myself, and I look around and I see everybody in the room, and I'm sure that's the case. I know it is.
We have so many. If you all could do me a favor, we are going to have that next one in January. Mm-hmm. That'll be at GRCC. I got to get with the bosses to see to nail the date down. But if everybody in this room told one person,
get a bigger room.
Yeah, this is all that was available, unfortunately.
And not just a Facebook post. No. Call people.
Yeah, I mean,
with a bigger room. Like, I do want to reinforce the point, though, that
we did
manage to fill this space to capacity with that. And so our problem was actually overflow. And there are certain space limitations no matter where you go.
Right.
And so that was why there wasn't, I guess, greater advertisement beyond Facebook, is because it just blew up so much. We were fearful that there was going to be 300 people trying to get in this room, and we just couldn't accommodate that, and we didn't want to turn them away. And so that was my fear. Like, it's a good fear to have, I guess, but I was honestly afraid that we were going to have hundreds of people, you know, knocking down these doors to get in this room. And that's a great problem to have, but it's still a problem. And that's why, like, I hope the next venue space that we find is going to be a little bigger.
It is.
And well, of course. But then also...
Weather's
a little better. It's not just the film screen, so...
I'm black. I can't go outside and be in the cold that long. You ain't going to catch me outside talking about go Bears or go Lions with no shirt on. Nope.
Can we follow you somehow? Are you blogging?
Yeah,
can we see your progress?
Yes, ma'am. I mean, I'm sorry. Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
It has been
a long day. I've been up since 5:30. I do have a Facebook page. It's called Reset GR.
Oh, okay.
If you can go to the Facebook and follow me via Facebook. Tonight I'll probably put up a video. I go live at least once a week. I also do have a podcast. One of my partners is here in the building. We have a podcast. The name of the podcast is called Hashtag Wake Up GR. Why do we say Wake Up GR? Right now, I believe Grand Rapids is sleeping.
Yes.
I believe we're sleeping. I believe we're sleeping and we're living and we're sleeping and we're dreaming. We're daydreaming. And when I say we're daydreaming, we're looking at the community. We're looking at downtown. They're throwing everything up so fast. Downtown is changing. Neighborhoods are changing. Neighborhoods are being gentrified. And what are we doing or saying? We have people, some of our family members, I don't care what color you are, some of our family members are getting ready to lose their house because of gentrification. So during this podcast, we talk about these issues. And honestly, if you listen to the podcast, you might hear us talk about some of the issues that are happening in the black community. And I'm just going to give you a disclaimer. There are some issues that the black community needs to handle on their own. We can't keep coming to white folks and the powers that be asking for money to help us solve our problems in the community. Absolutely not. No, we need to get together over here by ourselves and let's talk about this stuff that keep running rampant in our community. This stupid stuff that we got going on. We need to get a hold of our kids. We need to get a hold of these little bitty kids. We need to get the teenage pregnancy rate, the STD rate, all of that stuff. That stuff, that's a problem that we need to handle for ourselves. But what we need to do, once we get together, we need to bring one issue collectively. One issue. Focus on that issue. But then after they say, okay, we'll take that issue. Now you come behind them and say, oh, yep, here you go, because we got 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We got this issue. Now y'all talking about bully? That's how you bully. That's how you bully. I've never been a bully. I've been the one that get bullied. But that's how you bully and you make some noise. I'm coming together. Okay, we all talking about, we finna talk about this mass incarceration issue. Everybody come together and everybody talks about that mass. We together, we one, when we're focused on just this one issue. Okay, as soon as you say, okay, oh, I forgot to tell you, I got this over here in this pocket over here, and I got about 4 or 5 other issues that ties along with the mass incarceration issue because it all flows together. But we need to find one issue, and I just happen to choose mass incarceration because it's a huge issue. It's been a huge issue, but we as a community have not really fought and talked hard about it. I think I got one more person, and then I'm gonna close out because I don't want to hold you guys too long. Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to say that both of us are currently in school to be social workers. And I just want to offer up, like, Grand Valley space, you know, we're in classrooms with future social workers, which are, like, the voice of the future, I feel like. So just offering up our actions and words individually as a group, whatever you guys need. You know, we can get other people behind us and just our actions along to the community.
Before you leave. I know I don't know how many people I said that to, so I think I'm going to be here for a little while. But before you leave, please, those who are asked to see me before you leave, and even if I didn't ask you and you felt like you wanted to say something to me, but you didn't want to say anything out loud, I will be here. Please, come contact me, get a hold of me. You can ask these two. Especially him, this guy is super busy, and I will blow his phone up like the World Trade. I will email him, I will text him until he gets back to me, but he will. Let me move over here because he might jump on me. Yes, ma'am, who just asked that?
What is your name?
I'm sorry, my name is Julius Height. I represent a nonprofit corporation. The name of my corporation is called Reset GI. So if you hear me, if you're on Facebook, if you're on Facebook and you see hashtag ResetGR, that's me. Anything I say, I'm putting a hashtag behind it. If we're talking about the podcast, I'm putting a hashtag RakeUpGR behind it. Anything that I'm talking about social justice, criminal justice reform, whatever you want to call it, I don't believe in criminal justice reform. I believe reform is a band-aid. It's a band-aid. I think we need to tear the whole thing down and start over from the ground up and build the thing over again because right now, putting a Band-Aid over it, it ain't going to do nothing but just open the wound back up again, and it's going to get worse. That's just my take on it. But anything that I have that we talk about social justice, I put the hashtag WakeUpGR or hashtag ResetGR. And if you see that and you're commenting, please let's try to make this that hashtag go viral, at least here. But if we can make it go viral, now we can capture the attention of the people that has power and has some say-so that are over and have that celebrity status. We can bring these people here. We can bring the Colin Kaepernicks here. We can bring the John Legends here. We can bring the Commons here, the Van Joneses, the Angela Rise, the April Ryan, so that they can come and talk. If they won't listen to us at the city commission, I'm willing to bring these people here to put them on blast, to make them look bad. That's not my fault. We elected you to an office to do a job, and you decided that you didn't want to do it. You wanted to keep greasing your pockets. So if you want to grease your pockets, I'm going to be the one to expose you. We need to be that. We need to be that type of people to expose. Let's stop being afraid. Let's wake up and stop sleeping. Yes, ma'am.
Ava DuVernay was interviewed by Oprah right after this, and she's in the same boat that you're in. Tear it down. Start it over.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. I'm in total agreement.
Yeah.
Listen, it's about 9:45. I did not mean to keep you guys here this long. I apologize for the late start, but I want to infusely and emphatically give you guys a thank you for coming out. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm very humble. And I'm very grateful. Thank you so much. You guys have a great night. If I ask you guys to see me, or if you want to see me, please, I'll be at the table right out here.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Do you have a card?
Yes, I have a card.